Hello, welcome to the basic tutorial of Windows Form application using C#.NET. So first you need to start Visual Studio.NET. We are using Visual Studio 2010 here. We'll go for file and we'll select a new project. Now there are several options. First we'll select Visual C#. Under this there should be Windows. Now the templates that you get on the left hand side also depends upon how you have installed and after installation which you have taken as default language. Say if you have taken C++ as default language, C# option would appear inside other languages option. If you have selected Visual C# as your default option just after installation, the C# option will appear at the beginning. Now in the C# you have a Windows section. There are several different types of Windows applications that we can develop using C#. However, we intend to work with Windows Form application. So select Windows Form application. Select an appropriate location over here, wherever you want to store. So select your location and give an appropriate project name. Say for instance, I give a project name, say my first .NET. Now, once you give a particular project name, what C# is going to do is, it's going to create a folder by name of your project. I have selected the desktop location. So let us check out with the desktop location. You can see here, there is a my first .NET application. Once you go inside, you see something called my first .NET with a Visual Studio icon. This is your solution file. Now, once you have created this project, all the project related files will be stored inside this folder. Let us first see and understand what this project is all about. Now, in your project, you will be using different files, different classes. All of them will be stored inside something called the namespace. So namespace is just a placeholder for classes. .NET supports class oriented programming. So the project is essentially creating a namespace. Let us say now all your classes and all your other files are going to be present over here. Every classes will be present over here inside the namespace. Now you could have several number of classes inside one namespace. On the other hand, because this is a placeholder, you can also have other namespaces within this namespace. So you can create basically a hierarchy. This namespaces can also have their own classes and so on. Now, when you go inside this, the left side, you can see something called a toolbox. On the right hand side, you'll see the solution explorer. Just below it, you'll see properties and then the output window. Now, sometimes when you open your solution explorer, you might not see any of them or you might not be able to find where they are. You might just get this much. Don't you worry, just go for view and click on toolbox. You see the toolbox appears. Go for view, go for solution explorer. Solution explorer appears. View, property explorer. So property window, property appears. Now This is what we call a form. In order to see how it runs, just save everything using save button and click on start debugging or press F5. Let me reiterate, in order to run this, click on start debugging or press F5. So you see, your application runs. Now, once your application is executed, you'll see that this debug button is hidden over here, or debug button is deactivated, you'll not be able to use it. Sometimes what happens is, when you are working with .NET at the beginning, you might sometimes minimize this and then you do not understand why the other things are not appearing. If this is the case, when you don't find any other thing appearing, you could see there is a running text over here, which means that the project is running. You can then either close the form from here or you can stop the project from here. Now, what exactly is meant by running? When you create a project, you compile it successfully. Basically, you create an exe file. That exe file will be present inside your directory. So, you remember my first.NET is my project. If you go inside this, there is a bin folder. Go inside this, there is a debug folder. Go inside this, there is a exe file called my first.NET. When you click, you can see one form application opens. You can close it from here. So for running this application, you do not require any Visual Studio. That's the advantage. Coming back to this, a form is essentially a class. There should be a code behind. What you see here is called the designer mode, or the design, or simply the design mode. Now, this has been rendered with the help of a code. If you want to see the code, just select the form here. Once you select the form, at this place you see there are few icons. This obviously is the designer mode, and beside this, this is a code mode. So you can just click on the code. Look, every class, every form is basically a class. So you can see form1.cs, all the C# code will be with .cs extension. So the actual source code for form1 is in form1.cs. As I said, we'll have a namespace created when you create a project. Because our project name is myfirst.net, we see that a namespace gets created in myfirst.net. Now remember, as namespace is placeholder of the classes, all the classes would be present inside the namespace. You cannot declare any variables here. Namespace is just to store the classes. So you can only declare enumerators, you can only declare delegates, but you cannot declare any variables. Say for instance, you cannot declare any integer like this. .NET has got a very good compiler which just compiles as you keep on typing your code, and you'll immediately see the error coming in over here. So it does not apply that. Now, coming back to our code part, so myfirst.net is a package which stores your class by name form1, and this operator over here, as you must be knowing, is an inheritance operator. So form1 is being inherited from form. If you place your mouse just over it, you'll see the actual class is system.windows.forms.form. What it means is, there is a namespace called system. Inside that, there is one more namespace called windows. Inside that, there is a namespace called forms. And inside that, there is a class by name form. So this class form1 is derived from system.windows.forms.form. The system.windows.forms.form is one which gives it all the designer view that you are able to see. Now, if you ever remove this inheritance operator from here and you save it, when you go to design, you basically don't see any design over here. Alright, so Windows form has to be inherited from system.windows.forms.form. When we go back, we can again see this form one. Now, at the top, we'll see certain using statements. Look, .NET has got several classes readily provided to you for different purposes. For example, for file handling, for handling XML, for handling office document, for handling networking, for handling images, and so on. Now, some of the common namespaces that includes the classes which are commonly required for your applications are included using system. You can keep on including other namespaces as you require. Once you include a namespace, all the classes inside this namespaces could be worked with the project directly. If you do not include a namespace, say for instance, if I remove this namespace, you remember that form is coming from system.windows.forms.form. So if I remove this, compiler cannot find where from this form is coming. So under that situation, we can write system.windows.forms.form. This is also perfect. So in .NET, you can either include the namespace where a particular class which you are using belongs, or you can give the whole reference. Now, there is one particular system with this. When you type, say for instance, I type sys, automatically it keeps on showing you the hints as pop-up. Say when I type sys, is a small letter, but over here it is showing system, and you can also see that this is with a curly brace icon. This means that this is a namespace. Now, in order to reduce your effort for typing and to be more precise, you can hit enter. It will select the hint. Then when you give dot, there are other options coming. Now I require Windows, so I can select this pop-up with arrow keys. I select Windows, press enter with keyboard, it select Windows forms dot. Now look, it is showing many dialogues, many classes. I select form. So this is how it works. Now we'll go back to the design mode. You can increase or decrease the size of the form. You can change the caption of the form from the property editor. There is a property called text. Any button that you take in form, you can change its caption from the text property. The text is changing. You can change the background from back color property. Once you make the changes, press Ctrl S or save all in order to save this one. Now, when you execute, you'll see your form appears with new color and with new text. One of the interesting things that you should know is, look, C# is an object-oriented programming. Form 1 that you see over here is basically a class that I have already shown you. So what is it that when you change the properties, basically you are changing something called properties of the classes. Now, because any object will be initialized within the constructor, whatever changes you make over here will be initialized to the constructor. You see, there is a form1.cs. When you click, this is the class and this is the constructor of the class, right? Any constructor will be having the class name and will not have any return type. So any object of the class, when you execute, you are basically running an object of the class form1. So when you run an object of class form1, you start with the constructor. In the constructor, you see you are calling a function by name initializeComponent. Now in .NET, you can go to any function, just click over it, right click, go to definition. Let me repeat. You can go to any method in .NET by right clicking on the method and then selecting go to definition. You are now inside a method called initializeComponent. This will be also reflected from this part. As you can see, that it shows that you are within a method called initializeComponent. InitializeComponent is basically manipulated by the designer. So whatever design changes you make gets directly manipulated through InitializeComponent. This is also present in a subfile called form1.designer.cs. Now look, there is a text, welcome to my C# application. Now if I change this text and let me say hello world, and if I come back to my form1 design, I immediately see that the hello world is reflected over here. So whatever changes you make within InitializeComponent gets straight away reflected in your designer. There is one field called client size. Let me change this to something like 256 by 256. Let me go back to the design and you see the form is smaller now. You have given a back color. Now instead of this, we can have our own color, system.drawing.color.say red. And when you go back to your design mode, you could see that the color is turned into red color. Now, if you are not comfortable with the font and other things of the environment, you could click on Tools, Options, and in Environment, there are several options that you could use with your Visual Studio. You can select your specific options. And there is something called fonts and colors, through which you can actually change the font of, so let me change the font size to say 14, Now you could see that in my font is now appearing with larger text. So you can go inside Tools, Options, Environment, Fonts and Color to change the size of your font. Coming back to initialize component, so what we understand is we can change the design of the form either from the design mode or going inside the initialize method and changing it from there. Now, because .NET is a object-oriented programming language, there should be some starting point, or the program should know where to start from, because in my application I could have several forms. I could have form 1, I could have tens of forms. So how the application is supposed to know which form to start? Now, in your solution explorer, you'll also see something called program.cs. What this program.cs is, this is the application that will be responsible for running your project. Now, inside program.cs, you see a class by name program, where you'll see one static void main. One of the difference of main over here with respect to the main that we use in C is that the main, you can see, starts with capital M, and this is static main. So in one project there could be only one static main present in any of the classes, right? So .NET is going to create a class by name program and put a main over here for you. The last line is one that is responsible for running your project. It's application.run new form 1. So what exactly this with new form 1? Look, if I had to declare an object of class form 1, I would have been declaring the object in this way. Form 1, say some object equal to new form 1. So new form 1 is nothing but calling the constructor of the class. So whenever you call the constructor of the class, you basically create an object. So this is as good as replacing this with object. So application.run runs the object of a class which runs your project. So earlier you had new form 1 over here, which I have replaced entirely with this object. Now when you execute, it still executes the same. But there are certain interesting things. When you are initializing the object, you are basically calling the constructor. Right click, go to definition. From the constructor, you are initializing this component. Go to definition. Here you are changing the text, you are changing the size, back color to your suitability, which is reflected in the designer. Now, because whatever changes you are making, look over here, this comes with a keyword called this. This refers to the current object of the class. So meaning is, whenever you are creating the constructor of the class form 1, for the object for which you are calling the constructor, for that particular object you are changing the text, for that particular object you are changing the size, for that particular object you are changing the color. Now here is one object, right, for which I am calling this constructor. So the color property, the text property, the size property of this object will be initialized by the constructor. One of the principal thing with the object is that you can change its property at any time of the program. So I can always write ob dot. If I give dot, all the object properties will appear. One of the property that we have changed from initialize component is the text property. So let me write TE. Immediately you see text appears. Let me select text equal to welcome to integrated ideas. So I am initializing an object and then I am changing the text of the object to welcome to integrated ideas. When you go back to the designer mode, you see still hello world is written. When you run, you'll see the text being changed to welcome to integrated ideas. That's because these changes have been reflected not from the constructor. Once you call the constructor will assign the text hello world into this object. But after assignment also, you can make the changes into the properties. Object.text, we make welcome to integrated ideas. Whatever changes you make is outside initialize component. So therefore, they are not reflected inside the designer. But when you execute, the changes are reflected. In this same way, you can also change equal to system.drawing.color.say blue. The designer looks red. When you execute, this looks blue because you are overriding it to blue. So let us have a quick recap. We'll create a project which is nothing but creating a namespace. A form present in the project is basically a class inherited from system.windows.forms.form. The form will appear with a property editor through which you can change the property of the object called form1. This object is created by calling a constructor of the class form1, which in turn calls a method called initializeComponent. This initializeComponent is directly linked with your designer. So whatever changes you make inside your initializeComponent is also reflected in your designer. I make the changes here. You go to designer, you see immediately this is getting changed. So the changes into the properties could be made from initializeComponent or from the property editor, and then this form is executed through a class by name program.cs, which hosts the main part called static main, from where I run this class by running an object of the class application.run, which expects the object of a form and passing the object of a form. So I'm passing the object of a form and that runs. Now once you create the object, at any instance of time you can change the properties of the objects. I say object.text equal to integrated ideas. When I run, this text appears right then. Now let us start a little with the toolboxes. Let us create a simple button. Put some text, right? Execute it. Look, you have not changed anything with respect to button. You have just changed the text. So the text will be changed. You have just changed the back color. So the back color will appear different. However, you've not done anything with the button. So button will still appear, right? When you execute, there is a button on the form, and when you click, nothing happens. That's because you have not given any behavior to this button. Look, .NET is a C# .NET is an event-driven programming. That means the form doesn't do anything unless and otherwise you raise an event. We can raise an event through different components here. These are called the tools. When you drag and drop a button, I'll again show you the process. From the toolbox, you can click on a component, keep your mouse pressed and release it over the form. You can increase its size, decrease its size as usual as the normal way. Just change the text property just like you have changed the text property of your form. Now, this button is one of the easiest and simplest way to raise the event, and most predominantly it is used for writing simple events. Now, look, when I execute, I want something to happen every time when I click this button. So every time when this button is clicked, there is an event called button click, which will handle what has happened when the button is clicked. In order to do that, once you have your button, just double click on this button. When you double click on this button, a new method will be created by name button one click. When you go to your design mode, when you check inside the property editor, you'll see one tab like this. This is called events. Okay, there are two tabs, basically properties and events. So when you select the button and click on the events, you'll see several events associated with the button. Change UI cues, control added, control ranged, drag over, so and so. However, you'll also see that the click method already has a name called button one click. You can reach to the method name by double clicking from here also. Once you go inside the designer, and if you don't see any back color or anything in the property editor, which means that your event tab is selected, you can again select back your properties tab from here. Coming back inside the event, I want something to be done when this button is clicked. How can I do that? One of the simplest ways is to show a message box. We can display a message box in this way. One of the things that we did was removed using system.windows.forms from the top, which I'll repeat again, and messagebox.show. Click the button. Now we have some code with it. Let me execute. As many times I click my button, you see one message box appears. You clicked a button. As many times I click this, the message box appears. As many times I click this, the message box appears. So message box is one by means of which we can shoot up certain text. Say for instance, and when you click, the text appears. Now this is a static text, all right. How about giving some dynamic properties to the static text? So we can give input through something called text box. In your tools, you could see a property called text box. So this is one of the other common methods by means of which we give input. Now, whenever we work with the property, when you drag and drop a text box, you see in bold color text box 1. When you select the button, in the bold color you see button 1 small letter. text box 1, button 1, they are nothing but the name of the object. When we work with a larger project, huge project, it makes no sense to remember the controls as text box 1, button 1, every text box, every button, every control we will be having certain properties associated with this. Let us assume that this text box is something through which I want to enter a name. So it is always wise to change the object name. Say I'll give a hint like txt name. If you give a small extension before it, you can always remember that this is a text box. You do not always have to work with txt. You can give your own name, select your own name type, say for example tb name, which means text box name, or txt name, whatever you are comfortable with. I'm more comfortable with using txt name, so I have used txt as the starting point and followed by name. So we can change the name of the object from the property editor by changing the name properties. Alright, now what I want is that user should give his name over here, and when I click, it should give a welcome message. Now when you run this form, it appears like this. For a new user, it is impossible to know what he has to enter over here, isn't it? So we can tell the user what he needs to do, what he needs to fill using text boxes, using something called label. So labels are like static text. We can just change their text. For instance, enter your name here. Obviously this will have again the four color properties from which you can change the four color of the font. You can go to font properties, you can change the font color and so. You can also change the font color of your text box. Like this. So using label, we give static text. Generally static text are used to give some hints to the user, and input is entered through the text box. So let us execute this. Let us give some name. Click. It's still giving hello world. Now that's because I have not used any changes in the code that should reflect a welcome message with this name. Let us now go back. So what I try to do is, I want to show something which is dynamic, that is also a string. So suppose if the user gives Rupam, it should appear welcome Rupam. If the user gives Mohan, it should appear welcome Mohan. If the user gives John, it should appear welcome John, and so. So welcome is common in any case. After welcome, I have written one space because there should be a gap between welcome and the name. Now the next part, you do not know what the user could give. However, you know one thing for sure, that the user will be giving this input from nowhere else other than this text name. So user is going to put his name inside this text box. So whenever any text has got to be changed, it got to be changed from the text property. For instance, if I write Rupam, the text appears. So as when I'm writing in the text appears over here. When you write any text here, that will be stored inside the text property. So I'll get back to my coding, and I can just write welcome plus txt name dot text. Let me reiterate again. From the designer, I've selected one text box. We can change the font color, font size, back color of the text box. It is always good to change the name of the property of this text box such that the text box reflects what you are trying to do. It gets difficult for the user to know what needs to be written over here. That's why we use labels along with the text boxes to tell the user what you got to do. This is a text box where user will be giving his name. I want to show a welcome message with respect to this name. So inside this button click, welcome is a common text. I'll put it in a string. I'll give plus sign and I'll write text name dot text. This plus sign is a concatenation operator. So I am concatenating the name of the user with welcome and displaying in the message box dot show. Right. Something will happen now. Let me give Rupam. Click. It shows welcome Rupam. I'll give So this is more dynamic now. The form is doing something which is not consistent, which is not constant. So as you give right, perfect. So we are now able to work with three components at least. One is button, one is label, one is text box. Now let us extend this form and let us have a simple arithmetic part. Now in a form, whenever generally we have different concepts being done through a same form, we want to enclose the concepts using something called a group box. So you can take a group box, you can enclose them, give some name, basic, welcome message. So it looks great. It tells the user what exactly you are trying to do in this part. So generally we take a group box and we keep this part such that, you know, you can have several group boxes in your form and you can present several concepts. Now I want to do some addition. So I'll take one more group box, say one of the best thing with the group box is that you can change the back color of this to your suitability. So when you run, even though your form is blue, which of course through code I have made blue, you can have a group box with different, though a professional coding does not permit you to use too many colors, which generally we try to restrict the color to set of standard colors so that user doesn't get irritated with too many color differences. So it's not always good choice really to use red, green, blue and so on and so in the form. However, as we are learning, that's not a constraint for us. Let us go and learn. Let me change this color more or less to something that is more bright, because we are dealing more into bright colors as background. So let us have something like this as background. So when we are learning the .NET application at the beginning, you know, these bright colors, they make the learning quite more fun. Red, blue color, you feel like you are doing something. Coming back to it, let me have a label. I want user to give two numbers. Let me say that it is enter number one. Okay. So now I should also be having something called enter number 2. Now rather than clicking on another label, changing two of its properties, .NET provides you a fantastic option. You can select this, press Control, click and drag. Let me show you this again. Click, press Control, keep pressing Control, press click and move your mouse and take one part. Look, this is label 2, and when you select over here, a new object is created by name label 3, whose position is different, object name is different, but however, as you are copying from this one, text is same, but we can always change the text. We can make it enter number 2. Similarly, we can take in take our text boxes through this. Now, advantage with this kind of technique is that if you are pressing the control and copying the text box, you would not have to change all the properties manually. See, this text boxes now automatically have a bigger font. Now, as I have told you, that as a programmer, always give appropriate name to your controls. That makes the programming quite easy. So I'll give this as text number 1, txt number 2, and let me drag and drop a button. One thing that you must have noticed is that though I drag and drop the labels, I copied the text boxes, I did not copy the button. That is because there is an event handler associated with this. If you copy the button, you need to change the event handler. So avoid copying the button as it is. Through whatever you are entering the event, just select them fresh. So I have taken one button too. Let me change the text to say add. It is always wise to change the name, say button add. What I want to do is I want the user to give two numbers entering into these text boxes. So I want user to enter two numbers, say for example 43 and 54. When I add, I want the addition of it. As I have not written any code, nothing is appearing. However, the number will be entered into the text box itself, right? And we have already learned that whatever changes we keep inside the text box will all be reflected in the text property. When you keep your mouse over it, you'll see that the text property is a string. However, I need to now deal with the numbers. So if I write integer number 1, I need certain method of converting this text into integer. That we can do using int.parse and txt number 1.text. So you'll be entering the number into the text box, which will be present as the text property. That we can convert into an integer by calling integer.parse method, and then int n2 equal to int.parse txt number 2.text. In order to add them, n1 equal to n1 plus n2. I want to display them as a message box. Message box dot show. What you are going to show? N1, which is the result. However, message box expects its input to be text type. So the way you have converted an text into an integer, you can convert any data type in .NET into text type just by writing dot to string, right? Wow, it's great, isn't it? So we are able to now add this stuff with our first project. However, there is catch. What if I mistakenly as given a wrong input? If I say add, look, because you are trying to parse a text and because you have entered a wrong text, this process will be failed. That will make your application to crash. This is known as an exception. An exception will make the application to crash. Once the exception occurs, you'll find it very difficult to work with your form. It will be in yellow color. So at that time, you can stop the debugger from here. We can protect from exception using try and catch block. So it will first check if this is correct or not. If correct, it will execute, else it will come to catch state. And you can always take an exception object. So whichever block of code where you believe that there could be an error, enclose it within try. A catch section should follow immediately after the try, and here you can print what exception actually occurred. So if you execute 22, 10, add, it's 32. But if you give a wrong input, it will so show input string was not in a correct format and your application will not get hanged. Again, when you rectify your input, it will come back and start working. So, in our today's class, we have seen some basic starting up with .NET, how to work with fonts, colors. Fine, so we've been able to do our first task. Now the question is, how to open this application again, how to run this application again once I close up. So it's always wise to close the Visual Studio from exit button. It could save and exit. Remember, here is our folder in the desktop, my first .NET. So if you want to open your project again, all you have to do is just double click on this solution icon. All your previous tasks will be saved, all your classes, namespaces, design changes, coding, everything will be present here. Perfect. And you start your work just from here. You can keep dragging, dropping the control or make the changes in the code, whatever you intend to do. You can again do it over here. So file, exit, and in order to start our Visual Studio with this application, I can just double click on this application and start it. Now, if you want to work with only the exe, it should be present in your debug folder, bin debug folder. You can directly run. Right? And you can close it off from here. Hope your first class was enjoyable. How to work with simple codes, how to write event handlers, text boxes. I hope you enjoyed the basic tutorial and you are able to reproduce the work. Thanks for watching. All the best and good luck with your .NET running. Thank you.